Yes.
Okay. So this is the topic of the day, health information exchange. And I'm going to elaborate on health information exchange and the national level health information architecture that we are planning. So we have already discussed about the type of health information exchange models in the morning session. But just to summarize it briefly, there are primarily three types, you know, we discuss in the morning, but there are a few more. So we discuss about centralized model, where we have a centralized repository which store all the clinical data of the patient. And US started with this model, but this was a failure point for them because the single centralized model from a scalability point of view, from a failure point of view, is a single point of failure actually. A lot of performance issues come, a lot of failure points happen. So this was a major, you know, learning from that model that it is not suitable for any country of a larger size like India. Then, you know, other models were highlighted like federated model. We discussed in the morning this whole federated architecture. It talks about, you know, data owned by the respective organizations. And there is some mechanism of sharing and exchanging that data using a national interoperability. And there is a federation of different exchanges. It's not like one single exchange. It's a multiple exchanges that can act in consistent manner with each other. So that is a federated or distributed model. The third model is the switch model, basically. This I did not spoke in the morning, but I'm going to cover it because the health claim platform envisaged by NHA is exactly the switch model. And that is why they use the word claim switch, processor switch, this thing, that thing. So what is a switch? Switch is not a health information exchange, but switch is an enabler component in the health information exchange. It is a service that enables the exchange of information across multiple entities. But there are certain conditions in that, and I will elaborate more, you know, on the further things. So one is all the organizations are identified in the switch, basically. It's not a kind of any organization can join in that. Organizations are well identified. Like, for example, all the providers and payers have to register with the SCP platform before they allow the claim submission. And then there are certain standards to be followed. There are certain minimum certifications to follow. For example, NHA talks about the sandbox model. So this sandbox is like a test environment where they want to certify all the providers and payers to use their APIs, to test their APIs before they kind of hook to the claim switch. So it's not like any technology model will work in there. It's kind of well-defined APIs are there, well-defined interfaces have been defined. And using those well-defined hooks, the different you know, entities talk to each other using a switch. The switch model is exactly what SCP is talking about. Then we have the patient managed model. Patient management model is exactly the PHR that we are talking about. Like patient can carry their own electronic records and they can subscribe to the services that enable them to direct exchange their data. So basically our architecture in India, what MDHP talks about is not just federated architecture. It's like a brand of two things. It is actually a federated architecture plus a patient-managed health information exchange architecture. So both the things they are talking about. They are also talking about EHRs, judiciaries, but at the same time, they are talking about the PHRs also. So it's like a, so the last thing as in the slide is there. It's a hybrid model, actually. It can be a combination of any two, three models. So in our case, it is a combination of federated and hybrid models. And on the payer side, we will have the switch model. So these three models are going to be there in India for the health information exchange. Any questions here? Anyone?
Would it be safe to say that if you're an open source, if you're planning an open source architecture, then hybrid is obviously the better choice. Switch will have its limitations. Consolidated will have its limitations. Yeah. So it would have to be a hybrid of maybe federated and patient. Whatever else.
So basically, yeah, definitely, you know, open source technologies have a very definitive role to play in that. And we can very well achieve the hybrid model using the prevalent set of open source technologies, number one. But for the NHA platform perspective, the claim side, you know, the payer side perspective, I think the switch model is the right one. And the reason simple is because in the switch model, there is a directed exchange between the identified set of provider organizations and the identified set of payer organizations who are already kind of registered in the digital contract database. So basically, if you see the federated architecture, then any entity can exchange the data with any other entity. But in case of health information, in case of claim exchange model, there are the participant entities which are kind of already registered organizations who are involved in the submission of the claims between the provider and payer thing. So anybody cannot attend in that. So this is more like a directed exchange. And this is already part of the hybrid model, because if you see, even in the claim side, they require to assess the patient clinical documents during adjudication. So that will require the access to the PHR repositories, or maybe in future the EHR repositories also. So they will require the leveraging the federated architecture technologies there. So it's again kind of hybrid thing. So I would say between payer and provider, it's a switch-based exchange. But then between the payer adjudication engine and the PHRs and the EHR repositories, it's the federated. So it's again hybrid.
Understood. Thanks.
So I've already spoken about that. So I'm kind of one more thing I want to talk. The another way of classifying exchanges are based on three other criteria. So basically, one is the directed exchange, which generally the US followed. It was a directed mail-based exchange, basically. So they were using secure mail-based exchange of documents directly between providers. So different healthcare providers, they could electronically send and receive the information directly to each other through their secure mailboxes. So there was no kind of intermediary entity involved in that. It was a mail-based exchange. The mail was sent over the encrypted, secure, reliable messaging architecture. And so it was a direct mail. Some circumstances, this can also be relevant if you see, like, you want to directly send a report to a known provider who has sent a request to you. And you can get the credentials of that provider from the provider directory. So you can get the email and you can get the digital certificate of that provider from the provider directory, which is the doctor registry. And then using those, the doctor digital certificate and the email, some of the electronic documents can be directly shared as well. But the kind of architecture that NDHP talks about, they have not mentioned the directed exchange. So this was used in US. The other model is a query-based exchange, where like health providers raise a query for the specific information they're looking for. And based on their query, they are able to find and request the information on the patient and to get this information attended either from the PHR source or from the EHR source. So basically, first the request has to be made. It's like a query-based. So query will be raised and response will be received. The third model is the consumer-mediated exchange, where consumer is the patient himself, and patient has the ability to aggregate and manage his health information in their own DigiLockers. And they have the total control on their medical information, health information, and they can actually determine with which provider they need to exchange their document. So if you ultimately see our architecture in India, it's primarily query-based exchange. It's a combination of query-based exchange and the consumer-based exchange. So when we talk about PHR, it's all consumer-mediated exchange. When we talk about general EHR, it's a query-mediated exchange. Directed exchange is not in India. Any questions here? Raghav, Apurva, anyone?
No, sir.
So this is the architecture we are kind of proposing for India, the Indian Health Information Exchange architecture. So we have kind of highlighted all the layers here, the complete enterprise. This is a complete enterprise architecture of the HIEF. This is the piece I'm working with Vivek. So the data architecture speaks about the entire data landscape of the country. And this is actually in alignment with the layer 2 of the NDHB. So it talks about the core data layers, which includes patient identification, anonymizer, consent, security, etc. And it talks about data standards. So all the clinical standards, MDDS, so all sort of EHR standards. And then it talks about federated data lake and the data warehouses. So this data warehouses, the government level data warehouses will be maintained by at the state level and the national level. National level will maintain aggregated data lake. Yeah. Somebody want to ask anything? Okay. So the application architecture, basically we are talking about two major things here. One, we are talking about the EHR repository. The other, we are talking about the PHR. You know, I already, you know, spoke about this thing in the morning. So generally we have the concept of fiduciaries who will be maintaining the storage of the data and who will be responsible for ensuring the security, privacy, consenting part of the data while exchange. Even the PHR can, so basically what can be done? The PHR is a patient view of the data. So actually data is somewhere stored on the cloud and this data is virtually partitioned by the patient view. So all the documents pertaining to a particular patient, and he can access all these documents like these documents are stored in his own vault. So Microsoft Health Vault architecture, or, you know, lot of, you know, vault architectures, wallet architectures have been defined in the country. So two prime models have been kind of emerging out of the latest technology. One is a blockchain based health information exchange model is emerging out. And many organizations has recommended that in India. One study by some US organization has been done, research organization. So they are also recommending blockchain based health information exchange for the country. And PwC also has done one study where they are recommending the blockchain based, you know, health information exchange model for the country, where the metadata of all the, you know, records will be stored in the registry part, which will be part of the blockchain. And the respective repositories can be maintained at the fiduciary and the patient repositories level. So actual data will not be part of blockchain. It will be only the metadata which will be shared across. And since blockchain is a shared ledger, so everyone, you know, who is participating in that blockchain can access that, those pointers across the country. So you know, this is still a technology choice, you know, how the government want to go with that. The other is a simplistic conventional health information exchange, you know, that I'm going to talk about, which is generally followed in most of the international countries, including the Canadian InfoWay, you know, how they are kind of using. So I will talk about that. So they talk about EHR registry and the repository model. So generally all the clinical documents are stored on repositories, multiple repositories. And there is one registry per instance of exchange. So as I talked about, there can be multiple exchanges. There can be like Airtel exchange, or there can be like IDEA exchange. There can be multiple exchanges. Even within the same state, if it's a bigger size state like UP, Bihar, there can be multiple exchanges. And each exchange can be managed by a different tech vendor. But each exchange should have one registry, and it can have multiple repositories. It can have multiple EHR repositories. It can have multiple PHR repositories. All these repositories can be on different fiduciaries, maintained by different fiduciaries, but ultimately there has to be one registry. And this EHR registry will maintain the record pointers, basically pointers of all the records, which are somewhere in the EHR, basically. It is somewhere in some repository. So the pointers of those records have to be stored in the EHR. It's like a location pointer. It's like a telephone directory. So if I want to see the number of a particular person, before calling him, I will just check the index part of the directory, and I will check in the index using some alphabet or something. I will check what is the name starting with what alphabet, and based on the index, I will find the page number. And to that page number, I will get the detail of that person. Same way, this index of the book. Similarly, we have a EHR registry which maintains the index of all the records, which are maintained in the repositories. But each exchange, the condition is there should be one registry only. And then there are certain open APIs which interact with the registry to find the location of all these patients and retrieve them from the respective locations. So data is still residing at the respective systems, but, you know, their location pointers are maintained by the registry. And, you know, again, I want to highlight one point that in the federated architecture, there will be certain open APIs which communicate between one registry to another registry. So like, for example, there are two exchanges in UP. Now each exchange has its own registry. So there will be one API which will be interacting between both of them. So you can see this bi-directional arrow in between, in the middle layer. It's a federated query. So similar way, each exchange can make a, can issue a federated query to all different exchanges, and it can find the location of the particular record. So if you tell me, if let us say exchange asks, give me the health records of Krishan Bharadwaj across the country. So it will send a federated query to all the exchanges with my global ID, and it will ask like, okay, give all the record locations of Krishan Bharadwaj. So it will return me all the 50 records or 500 records, whatever are, you know, across the country. It will give me the list of all the record pointers. And whatever record, you know, then I want to access, I can just, you know, send a request to that record location and I can fetch that. So it will give me the longitudinal, you know, record access of that patient. Any questions here? And then, you know, registries play a very big role here, because when you're tagging the data, you're storing the data in the repositories. I'm talking about the fiduciary maintained repositories. This has to be in certain structured format. Whatever data is stored in your provider system, it is kind of unstructured data in the sense local identifiers are used. They are using clinical standards. They are not using clinical standards. But when you are storing it in the fiduciary, in between, there should be standardization of the data. And the reason is very simple, because when you are exchanging this data with the other partner, other entity, the meaning of the data should be carried. This is the semantic part of the interoperability. And for this, all the terminology should be mapped in SNOMED, all the you know, diagnosis thing should be mapped in ICD-10, or kind of all the lab investigation should be done in the, you know, missing LOIC. So that's data standardization thing should be carried. And all the identifiers should be mapped with the global identifiers. So whatever be the local identifier of the patient in the respective health application, but when you are tagging the data in the EHR registry, it should be tagged with you know, some kind of a global patient identifier. We call, and this identifier should come from the master person index. So you need a master person index at the national level. You need a facility registry which will be a unique identifier to all the facilities. No matter if, even if it is today 3 registries, no problem. It is a NIM registry. It is a Rohini maintained database of the hospitals. But, you know, an NHRR allocated thing, but through these 3 identifier, we should have a way of tagging them to a unique identifier. So that exercise need to be done, which is called at harmonization of the work across the registry. So we can kind of create a registry which can populate the data from all these 3 different registries, and as I know, a linked identifier, which link the records from all these 3 locations. Then provider registry is a doctor registry, basically. So all these registries and frontline worker registries, all these registries are required. Along with that, some more registries will come in, which will be like a disease registry, as is required in the COVID condition. So we feel like there should be the disease registries in place. It can be at the state level also. I mean, it's not required that disease registry has to be there at the central level or something, but there has to have a way of linking all these registries together. So a federation of registries is required. Similarly, drug registry. So we have, you know, we are working on the design of these things.
Krishan, just one question. Yeah. These registries which you are specifying here and saying that each exchange has multiple registries, so are they at state level? Like, what is the level they are at? State, central, or exchange? Like, where will they reside?
Okay. So basically, I said like each exchange should have a EHR registry. So EHR registry is exchange specific registry. That is part of the exchange. So whatever number of instances of exchanges are, even if within a state there are multiple instances, so each instance of exchange should have one EHR registry, and it can have multiple repositories. Now, along with this EHR registry, there are certain national level registries are required. Like I spoke about patient registry, facility registry, and the doctor registries. These all have to be at the national level.
Centralized
national level. And okay. Then we have the health worker registry. Again, health worker registry has to be at the central level, but there can be certain directories as well. So along with the health worker central registry, you require the employment directory, some kind of application which is maintaining the payments of the health worker, employment detail of the HR part of the health worker. Those applications will be at the respective state level. But okay. There will be a single place at the central, maintained at the center, which is kind of holding the records of all the health workers which are registered across the country. Similarly, we need a drug registry at the central level, because we need to allocate a national level drug code to all the drugs. So that has to be at the central level. And, disease registry, we can take a decision whether we can make a disease registry at each, state level, maybe district level also. And then there has to be one single, central registry, which is kind of holding the pointers of all the records, which are updated somewhere in the state level registry. So that can be maintained at the state level.
Okay. Thanks.
So then all these, components are stitched together by an interoperability layer. So we need a strong SOA-based interoperability layer, which kind of integrate all these components together. And this is a service bus architecture, SOA. So that takes care of all the routing part, all the transformation, mediation part, messaging, queuing. So those, whatever standard, SOA provides. And since the open source thing, a lot of open source SOAs are available. So Ved is already working on one WSO2 ESB. So that is a kind of open source ESB. Along with that, there are a lot of others available. Then on top of that, we have highlighted the business architecture piece. So what all things will be achieved once you have the HI in place. So we will be kind of standardizing the clinical workflows, clinical pathways. Referral network will be strengthened. So if you want to send the patient from one location to another, and you want to kind of share the provider objects of that patient to the other doctor at the other location, you need an interoperability layer. Telemedicine and telehealth platform will be strengthened, because video call, audio call is one aspect of the thing, but exchanging of the data, patient medical records, the vital signs, and many other details that require a strong interoperability layer, and then also the exchange of the DICOM files of the patient. So that everything has to be strengthened to make a strong telemedicine platform across the country, and HI has a big role to play in that. Then other pieces are like disease management. We need a COVID disease registry, and we need the HI mechanism to exchange the data from multiple facilities, be it in the payer side, public side or the provider side, and then ability to kind of roll up that data and aggregate that at the state levels and the national levels. So like, as I said, DHIS2 platform that can be used for aggregating the data and generating the indicators, MIS indicators. And then on the claim side, we have a very strong case of claim adjudication platform, claim exchange, health claim platform. So that, these are all the kind of specific scenarios that require, some kind of health information exchange thing. And all the application, different applications can be built on top of that. We can have multiple patient apps, provider side EMR systems, public health programs, pharmacies, radiologies, payers. So all these different business entities will be availing this health information exchange. Yeah. And one more thing is, along with this EHR thing, I spoke, there will be PHRs. So PHRs will be patient-owned, data basically in their own wallets, I spoke about. So all the same set of privacy, security, consent will be followed on that. Plus, there will be mechanism of the patient can share their data with any provider for whatever time period they want. So that kind of capability should be there. So either PHR can also be owned by the respective fiduciaries on their, so storage part can be managed by the fiduciaries. And plus all the security, privacy, consent thing can be managed by the fiduciaries. The rest of the locker, API interactions, everything can be managed by the different tech vendors who are designing the applications. So this is one model which we can emphasize. So all the data will be kind of in one place and management will be easy. So any questions here? This one slide I've taken from Kiran's slide deck. So this is the way he's looking for the PHR thing. So what he says is, this slide is like all the health data will stay with the providers. In the bottom layer, he's showing all the hospital diagnostics or clinics or labs or whatever. So data will be actually residing there. So when I say data, it means like patient discharge summary or diagnostic reports, prescriptions, etc., encounter related data. Then we need some sort of, so when we are exchanging the data. Now, exchange part comes in play. Whenever you are exchanging the data, you need a common data format. So if somebody asks you why objects are required, so a very simple answer to that is, your data within your system can be in any information model, but when you are submitting it to the external world, you need a common format. It's like a common currency. So consider the international cases. In our country, we have the rupee. In US, you have the dollar somewhere. Each country has its own currency. So long in their own country, they are fine with their own currency. They can manage all the financial transactions. But whenever they want to do the exchange, if I want to buy some book from the US, Amazon or something, I need to pay in dollar. So that you know, some mechanism should be there to kind of convert my rupee into dollar when kind of I'm initiating the financial transaction with them. Same way, we need a common record format when we are exchanging the data. So if you see the EHR standard, so EHR standard talked about EHR archetype model as a common record architecture thing. So they propose this model, but you know, hardly anyone in the country except UK has used this model, and it's a very complex model. So then instead of such a complex model, FHIR was a much easier model, and this could be adopted on lean devices as well. Like you can adopt FHIR on mobile, you can do whatever. It's a JSON format thing, so you can integrate on any device thing. So it was a much easier technology. So then NDHP, instead of recommending the archetype model from the EHR standards, they proposed FHIR to be the standard for all the you know, record format thing. The format, so basically FHIR is a messaging standard, but as well as it defines the record structures in the form of resources. So you have all the FHIR resources which define the structure of the records. The same way when we are defining the E object, we are defining the structure of the payload. The message which needs to be sent, like for example, if it's the E prescription, my prescription document should look like this. It has so and so many segments, so many data elements, so many standards. Same way discharge summary, same way claim document. So we have kind of defined the schema of, you know, all the different clinical documents. So going forward, the strategy is that all the PDF reports will be kind of slowly replaced with all the electronic documents, discharge summaries, electronic prescriptions, electronic lab reports. So we need to generate many more e-objects as well, like lab reports, radiologies. So each and everything we need to cover in the e-object structure. And, you know, then this particular slide, they're talking about health data access fiduciary, which is HDAF. So HDAF take care of all the consent part, security part, management part. And then on top of that, we have the PHR, which is the real-time data aggregation. So basically, if you see like this HDAF expose all the open APIs, and PHR leverage these open APIs, you know, to kind of store the data, to exchange the data, to take care of privacy, security, and the consent. So this is the slide I've taken from Kiran. This is the mindset they have. Raghav, any question here? Or anybody?
No.
So this is the kind of model we are envisaging for the country. If in a pilot scoping, if we have to do a pilot, for example, for a health information exchange, so we have to take our interoperability layer. Then, you know, all these different health workers, they are already using the Comcare based applications from Dimagi for the ICS CAS, and, you know, Anaita can highlight much better on that part. Then there is another tech platform called Motech. This is used by Bihar. In many Bihar state, many pilots have been done using the Motech thing. So Motech is again an application which generates the, you know, event alerts, the mobile-based communication, all these things. So these are so Comcare.
Motech is also developed initially.
Okay, fine. So Motech and Comcare is an easy way to develop the mobile applications faster. So it is like a questionnaires can be built using the Comcare platform, and it can ultimately be developed as a simple mobile app. So this is on the public side. The private side, you know, is led by the innovation thing. So our SCA members, they are already developing a lot of, you know, mobile applications, smartphone-based applications, teleradiology, telemedicine-based, disease surveillance-based, you know, thing we can develop. So all these different applications, they will be integrating with the interoperability layer using different open APIs. So that API signature definitions, you know, everything I'm kind of working on, I will be releasing that. Now, on the source application side, you have all these different applications which will be connecting together. So we have kind of, you know, all these analytical kind of applications where you need to aggregate the data, and also you need DHIS2. DHIS2 is commonly used in the Kenya, Africa, and it's funded by the BMGF. So it's used in many countries. So we can propose this model for the small scale pilot thing. Then we can take all these mobile applications. Clinical record systems, so our SCA members are already building the HDAS products. Provider TMS we can include in that. Then hospital information system, laboratory information system, and many more systems. Payer TMS and all these things. Then we need the different registries. We need a facility registry. We need a client registry, which we call as a patient registry. We need a personal health record repository, which UniMagnet is working as a MediLocker. We need the registry of health terms. This is the code directory things we are working. So we are kind of working on designing the schemas of all the code directories and the MDDS elements. Then we need the registry of health workers. So design part we have done. So all these registries also, we can take the simple OpenHI model. So OpenHI has done some piloting. We can take some of, so although it is not at the national level, to be honest, but for the piloting scope, we can take some of the components, you know, from what they have done to develop these registries, at least at the pilot prototyping stage. And all these different parts will be kind of stitched together using the interoperability layer. So basically, using that, you can do a small pilot, which will be showcasing the simple health information exchange model that we are proposing. So, any questions here?
Krishan, just a quick one. So is this what we call sandbox as well?
Yeah, exactly, Komal. This can act like a boundary of our sandbox. Because okay. We cannot develop the national level full-fledged product thing. We can choose, pick and select the combinations from the open source list. And we can develop something quickly to demonstrate to the rest of the people that this is the HI thing, this is the way it works. And then if you want to kind of utilize it at the national level, you need to build the full sandbox thing. So many of the features can be borrowed from there.
Okay.
So yes, that will define the boundary of the HI sandbox.
Okay.
So for example, on the top side, if you see the DHIS2, that can act as an aggregate server for all the, you know, IDSP report part. So currently they have the L report, S report, whatever, the different reports. They need to kind of aggregate the data from those reports and generate the indicators. How many corona suspected cases are, confirmed cases are, death reports, all this thing. So DHIS2 we can use. So that is already kind of a built-in server. With some effort, we can kind of do this prototyping. Another slide, you know, I'm kind of highlighting the health exchange APIs, how it will leverage in the payer provider interaction and how it will benefit the NHA thing. So NHA is already working on the SCP platform, which is primarily between the provider and the payer system. And the provider TMS thing, they will send the claims and the different, you know, transactions like eligibility verification thing, request, response, then claim response, then payment notice, all these things. So that will be an interaction between provider and SCP thing. That is on one side of the thing. The other side of the thing, SCP will talk to different payers and it will route the respective information that is coming from the provider side and it will route it to the respective payers. So on the payer side, there will be a payer TMS system and that will be kind of processing the claims, adjudicating it, doing the fraud management part or kind of data insights and all sort of. But if you see the totality, how HI fits in that, so as shown the blue color, you know, document. So basically all the red color things are what is the plan of NHA. But then all the blue color things are, you know, what the HI comes the role here. So HI, we have primarily EHR repositories, we have EHR registry, and then we have PHR. So all these are basically PHR and EHR are the different, repositories which are kind of storing the patient data or kind of data from the different providers. So when we are submitting the FHIR claim, object to the SCP platform, it is routed to the payer side. So if they want to access the discharge summary, for example, the discharge summary is not part of the claim object. It is only containing a link of the document. So this link should be pointing to somewhere. So what NHA team is thinking is that most of these documents will be stored in the PHR repository of the patient and the direct address link of that record will be provided, in the e-claim. So that the adjudication engine can directly fetch the record from the PHR using this link. It's like a HTTP link. So if you might have seen that if you have a link embedded in a web page and you click that link, you open that page and then you can do the processing. So that is a thought process they have. But going forward, they need to extend it to another level where, because, you know, all the illiterate people, the village people, they cannot maintain their PHRs. And even if they maintain the PHR, how will they know, you know, where my records are and, you know, how will I will give the consent part and those things. So generally, EHR repository, because all the data is generated by some facility. And whatever data is generated by the facility, that is stored in some of the fiduciary maintained repositories. We call it EHR vendor repositories. And the pointer of all those records are stored in a registry. So as I said, like each exchange will have a registry. So using these registry repository model, NHA can get the location of all the record pointers and it can fetch the records from the respective EHR repositories as well. So if patient want to share it for the OPD scenarios, fine. Otherwise, they will always get the record access from the EHR repository. So this thing is currently missing in their architecture, and we will discuss more with Kiran on that. So, and then, certain dots I'm showing here. So all the red dots are basically all the privacy, security, and the consent part. So whenever there is an exchange of document, there has to be these three important aspects which need to be taken care of. And one more thing is basically this green color thing. If you see in this on the top. So you have on the top, you have the registries. And the green color arrow is basically the interaction between the registry to get all the identifiers. So this interaction will be at the SCP level also, and this interaction will be at the registry level also, and the PHR level also. So you need all these interactions. And then you can see the yellow color arrow on the upper left side of the page. Between the EHR repository and EHR registry, you have the yellow color arrows. These are basically the lookup things between the registry and repositories. So registry is like a book index. Repositories are actually your records. Now, there can be n number of repositories, but to look at the exact location of the record, you need to see the index to quickly find the location of the record.
Yeah.
So this is the interaction between the two. The HIE will play the role here. And as I said, like in federated HIE, this one registry can send the request to all other registries also. So this will be kind of a telecom model, as I many times discussed that. So this way, you can retrieve the record from any of the other exchange. And that will act as a federation between the exchange. So those are the missing components, which once they plug in, that will make the complete exchange of the clinical document of the patients with all the security, privacy thing, consent thing taken care of, all the PHR, EHR, and the health link part. So this makes the complete scenario for the health information. Any question here? So what we are doing is we are kind of elaborating each of these frameworks. So we are working on what this consent thing should look like, because the MITRE consent framework will not be sufficient. That is more from a financial perspective. So we are defining it from a healthcare perspective, how this consent thing will look like, how this data privacy security thing will work, what are these different API interactions will be, what the PHR structure will be. So all this thing will come as part of our HIEF report that we are working on. These are some of the basic services of the HIE. So any general HIE works, basically it uses these services, and these services will be developed as the open API specification. And like the microservice design document, we will be publishing the APIs, API design of all these services. So then any vendor who want to design the HIE using any technology, they can develop it in their choice. So we need a registry and directory services, which is actually the lookup between the registries, basically. It can be the national level registry, like we need the APIs to interact with facility registry, APIs to interact with the master patient index, APIs to interact with health worker registries, both for the population, retrieval, updation, and the authentication, those things. So we need the interaction with all the registries. So these will come collectively as the registry and the directory services. This is one of the important parts in the HIE. The other important part is the person and entity identification. So as I said, like before populating the EHR registry part, we need to tag the records with the unique patient identifier. And till the time this unique patient identifier comes in the country, we can have some sort of logic where we can use the multiple IDs to identify the same patient. So we have to maintain a kind of a map. A mapping of all the different IDs that patient has. So somewhere patient has given a voter ID, somewhere has given Aadhaar or something. So we need to kind of tag all these IDs collectively and to create an index of all these IDs. So basically entity identification, we need to follow the probabilistic and deterministic algorithms. So already well-defined EMPI products are available, which kind of do the patient matching. Based on the deterministic and probabilistic algorithms. So deterministic means when you exactly identify the patient based on some 4 or 5 demographic attributes, name, date of birth, etc., mobile number. Probabilistic is when you have kind of closest matching between the records. Sometime I give my mobile number for my family member, although this is not his mobile number. So that will also come in the probabilistic matching, but that can be done by some human review or some mechanism can be provided to identify this is the ID of the same person. So then another service we require is the record locator and search service. I will talk more about it in the slide. Identity management we need because all the service security privacy thing we need to manage, and consent management and secure data transfer. So these are the minimal services, MVP services that need to be designed in a HI. The registry part, I've already spoken of. So honestly, if you see each hospital maintain a master data table, if even today, if you see any HIS system, they always have a master table where they are storing their facility detail, organization ID, different branches of that hospital. Then under that, how many employees are working, they are giving the user IDs to them. They are defining the role of those IDs, doctor, who is nurse, who is what. But this is the local level data. We need to maintain this data at the national registries level. So basically so that we can assign a unique identifier, which is unique across the lifetime of the person. And this is the record locator service I was talking about. So generally, this is why we need a EHR registry in the HI landscape. So if you see this workflow diagram, so number one, the healthcare practitioner make a request for the record location of the patient. So it make a request to the patient index, which is like a record locator service, RLS. Then this RLS, either itself find all the record locations, and then it requests the other HIs also to provide the locations of the record. For example, some of the records it might be maintaining, some of the records other registries might be maintaining. So it will issue certain service. So it will first search its own directory, its own database, and then it will make a request to all other registries also to provide the locations, location pointers. And once it gets the complete information, it will return the complete index of location of patient records to the practitioner. So now practitioner has a complete list of the location, like this hospital patient has got this treatment, this hospital patient has got this treatment. So it has a patient unique ID, it has a provider unique ID, it has a facility unique ID. So that is why registries are required here. And then, using this index, the healthcare provider, now you can see the green arrow here, it make a request of the patient record from the clinical data source. So because he has already got the location, so now he make a request to that location for the required. Now this location can be a PHR, this location can be a EHR repository. So anywhere his records are, it will make a direct request. And that source will service the request and it will provide the patient medical health records. This is the fourth part. And before kind of providing that, it will take care of patient consent thing. It will check the patient consent document, whether this is allowed or not allowed. So all this, data privacy, security, all these things will come in. And after following this privacy part, security part, it will provide the patient records. And finally, it will also publish any location of the new medical record, which is populated in that repository. So this is a pink color arrow on top. So whenever a new record is updated in the PHR or any EHR repository, it is populating the index of that in the record locator service. So record locator service plays a very important role in kind of coordinating between the repositories and the source systems. So if you see the Kannada model again, Kannada model record locator service has a very important role to play. So the same model we kind of proposing for the country. So this is a well-established process in the federated architecture. Kannada InfoWay, and Dr. Pankaj is an expert in that. He has already worked in that. So this is the closest architecture to the federated architecture thing that we are talking about. And it's one of the successful HI architecture in across the globe. Any questions here? So one more thing is when you are maintaining the registries, for example, you are maintaining the doctor registry. So along with the doctor details, you can also maintain like the digital signature of the doctor or like the email address of the doctor if doctor allows to do a direct messaging. And if you feel like certain corner scenarios, you want to do a direct messaging of the data as well. So those kind of different hybrid models are possible and permissible. Basically, so those are also kind of thing when you already know this doctor has put the request and doctor has given the authorization, and patient and doctor already has signed the consent. So instead of routing this complete thing route, you can do a direct secure messaging as well. So those are the different technology models that we can discuss with the, you know, different expert teams, whether we should do a hybrid thing or we should just follow the federated architecture in the true sense. This is the identity management part. I think Priyanka asked in the morning one question, like, what are the different security controls to be followed? So some of the things, I have kind of highlighted here, and we will be detailing it out more. So one is on the credentialing side, we need to take care of the authorizations and the certification part. So digital certificates are required, and it will define that. So we need an attribute level access control. But till now, nobody is talking about attribute level thing. So when I'm saying attribute level, within a single record, there can be sections of the record which patient want a different kind of access control. For example, in a given episode, two or three different morbidities are kind of detected along with the primary diagnosis. Now, some of the morbidity data are kind of sensitive patient data, which he does not want to disclose with others. So when he's sharing that episode data to the other provider, he wants to share the rest of the thing, the main diagnosis, everything he wants to share, but he wants to hide that morbidity related detail. So how is it possible if you're kind of allowing the control at the complete record level, whether kind of make completely secure everything or kind of remove security from everything? So it's kind of 100% or 0%. This will not work. We need an attribute level mapping where patient can decide, okay, I want to show all my primary diagnosis thing, but I want to hide this particular morbidity thing. And I want to allow only the access by the authorized provider only to this part, who is doing my treatment, not to rest of the people. So that kind of attribute level access control is required in the country. So that is possible only when you're defining authorization mechanism and the certification mechanism. On the provisioning part, we have a different identity access management things. It takes care of patient identity, authentication, access controls, directory services. So that takes care of all your users, roles, the different identity management techniques. Then on the federation management side, because we have the federated architecture, so whenever we are exchanging the data from, for example, in the NHA case, we are saying that whenever claim will be sent from provider to payer, it will be signed by the digital cryptographic keys of the SCP as well as the payer. So this everything comes in the encryption and certificate part of that thing. So that takes care your data is not kind of tampered. It takes care of confidentiality, integrity of data. So that certificate exchange thing need to be taken care of. Your transport layer should be highly secure. It should be SSL. It should be TLS, transport level security. Communication security standards. Like if you are using SOAP web services, we need to follow WS addressing model. It's a little bit technical. So this is one of the prime security thing in the SOAP web services. SAML, this is a security assertion markup language. So these are the different techniques using which we can do the data security and privacy. Then we need to do the auditing and the reporting. So we need to do a data provenance. We need to maintain the audit logs of all the exchange data requests, who made the request, when made the request, when this request was serviced, when patient granted the access, and all the usage reports. I already spoke about one more important thing is that we need to kind of anonymize the data or kind of deduplicate the data, de-identify the data before kind of exchanging that. But in the government analytical sources, as Dr. Pankaj shared one link, there are certain scenarios they should be allowed to recover and re-identify back the data if they want to provide the further health protection to that patient. So it cannot be permanently kind of de-identified. So de-identification will be preferred over the anonymization, because anonymization is a completely irreversible process. Once done, you cannot recover back the patient. So all these identifiers need to be encrypted. So web service security side, we have different protocols which you can follow to ensure security to the web services, both on the REST service side as well as, so we have the JSON token-based authentications, JWT authentications, OAuth authentication, and then different other protocols you can follow for the web service security. Then again, on the web service messaging side, we have different digital certificate formats conforming to X509. Kerberos is another security authentication protocol. SAML is another I'm speaking with. taking about. And then all these messages should have a header, which should contain the security credentialing. So like in JSON, the E object that we are designing, we have a header part. Right now, we have not included the hash key part of that. So we need to discuss with the NHA and the payers what the hash key they will provide. So those need to be embedded in the header part of that. So that will be kind of taking care of the security aspect. So these are some of the controls which need to be maintained at the data security and privacy level. I know it's a little bit technical. Any questions here?
Just a small question. From a patient point of view, how will patient know that what level of access he has to provide, right? He may not want to give all the history of him or just till last certain time or till last certain episode. So that's how it is going to be.
See, this is a good political question you have raised. Now, if you see this answer, I mean, there are two ways of answering it. One is the purely technical approach of giving the answer to this question. And the other is the kind of different, aspects related to that. One is kind of educating the patient. And if you see the total population of the patient, how many patients know what is the consequence of hiding or unhiding a particular record? At best, they can know is like, okay, if there is some sensitive, some patient is HIV patient, he doesn't want to disclose it to his HR. He has hidden it completely. So basically that may be sensitive to him, but rest of the thing, he may not be aware, what disease he want to hide or unhide and how much extent he want to unhide or hide. So primarily what I feel is one is the education part, and then the illiterate segment of the country, you see, they are totally unaware. They don't know the consent at all. What is it? So even if you do the Gramvani programs and all, and you teach them in some simple language, ki bhai apne records ko save karao, share karne se pehle kisi ko mat batao, all sort of thing, they will understand something, but they will not understand the full implications. So primarily what NDHB is saying is, and what I feel is, health data fiduciary should have a bigger, understanding of the total overall implication of the data. And whenever you are kind of providing any sensitive patient thing, it should be tagged in a certain manner at the point of capture of the record. Okay, this is a sensitive patient data. It should be flagged in the clinical systems. Ye wala data jo hai, sensitive data. And then all the sensitive data should have a different policy of data security and privacy and consent than the rest of the records. Mm-hmm. So ultimately, provider is the best, judger of that thing. तो जो डॉक्टर है उसको पता होता है कि ये जो मैं अभी एपिसोड में जो रीजन दे रहा हूँ ये सेंसिटिव इन्फॉर्मेशन है कि नहीं है. खुद मुझे भी नहीं पता. अगर आप मुझसे भी पूछोगे तो आई विल नॉट से कि व्हाट इज सेंसिटिव व्हाट इज नॉट सेंसिटिव. सो ही शुड बी काइंड ऑफ मेकिंग वी शुड बी मैंडेटिंग इट फॉर ऑल द क्लिनिकल प्रोवाइडर्स. नंबर वन, टू फ्लैग समवेयर इन द क्लिनिकल सिस्टम्स कि दिस इज अ सेंसिटिव डाटा. नंबर टू, वी शुड गिव द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टू द फिडिशरीज टू असाइन अ डिफरेंट लेवल ऑफ सिक्योरिटी एंड प्राइवेसी टू दैट सेंसिटिव पोर्शन. And maybe using patient OTP thing, or maybe kind of making a call to the patient IVR or jo bhi kuch karke usko bataya jaye ki bhai tumhara ye sensitive record hai, you want to share that or not. So that kind of consent framework need to be brought in.
Okay.
We baki technical mein to everything 100% or 0% wala chal raha hai. Abhi patient ko bol doge aap consent de do to de dega aise. So kya pata.
It can't be 0 and 100%. It has to be somewhere in between.
So that is what I'm saying. We have to follow attribute level control, not a record level control.
Right.
Yeah. So some examples there. For example, the PNDT Act. Under the PNDT Act, the gender of the child cannot be disclosed, even though the radiologist may have studied it and it is part of the study record. But it cannot be disclosed. So it's a sensitive record. The second thing is MTP. Under the MTP Act, the MTP details cannot be disclosed. So, it's up to the woman to sort of decide who, when, and if at all. But it's a sensitive record. Jabki hamare country mein wo implement hi nahi kiya hai. Matlab, it's available to everybody. Which woman underwent how many MTPs? It is a public health thing. Everybody knows it. I mean, this is absurd actually, but under the MTP Act, clearly that record is sensitive and cannot be declared. HIV, the positive HIV cannot be declared. So these are the kind of things that have to be marked sensitive, and then, you know, a separate level of security has to be assigned.
So, sir, what I'm feeling is we should publish a white paper on this, basically. Okay, what kind of records should be marked as sensitive and how we should control those sensitive records in the overall strategy.
भैया मैंने किया था रिपोर्ट को फाड़ दिया गया
सर अब नहीं फाड़ेंगे कोविड के बाद नहीं फाड़ेंगे
नहीं सिंपल थिंग एमटीपी इज अ पब्लिक हेल्थ थिंग व्हिच इज नोन टू एवरीबॉडी बाय लॉ दैट इज इलीगल
So in a way, it has to be multi-layer, right?
Yeah, it has to be multi-layer. So, you know, basically what India needs is a law like HIPAA.
Right.
HIPAA very clearly states that, you know, it is the clinician's judgment that is supreme. So the clinician has to decide. Now, very similar thing has been done in the telemedicine guideline, which has come out recently. All the liability on the head of the clinician, which is called as, you know, registered. And the RMP has to decide as to what is sufficient. It does not, so, you know, the telemedicine guideline doesn't say what is sufficient. It says sufficient, left to the RMP to decide.
Okay. Interesting.
Yes. So as I said, like consent management is 80-20 principle, Komal, in your language, Pareto law. So basically 80% is all policy related thing and 20% is only is technology. So
yes.
The exact question that we are So exact question what we are discussing is all policy related things.
Right.
Yeah. So technology wise, we have the extensible access control markup languages available, AccessEML, which I'm going to propose in my design. And because this is not being spoken in the MIT consent framework architecture or neither by the iSprit team, the work they are doing. So we need the attribute level consent security, but we are the scenarios we are discussing. And that can happen only when you have a declarative access control policy language kind of thing. So it is a markup language. And I think Kiran is already aware about the policy markup thing. He talks about policy markups in different other contexts. So for consent, we exactly need a policy markup language. So this is already AccessEML is a well-defined established framework, technology framework available to us, and we can leverage it. So that will help us to kind of mark a certain part of the record as sensitive, certain other part of record with a different policy. So it will be defining the policies. And then we will have the policy enforcement engines, which will be kind of rule engine, which will be enforcing those policies at the real time runtime. So that will ensure the person who is accessing, he has the credential to read it or to write it, to store it. Now, if patient has revoked that consent, so automatically that storage should be flagged off. So that document should disappear from his storage. For example, the payers. All the documents which are exchanged from the provider to the payer, they should not be allowed to store at the payer side for infinite time. They should be allowed only for the claim adjudication part. And even in the fraud detection part, they at max, they should use the anonymized or deduplicated data. Because what they have to do with the patient mobile number or those things, you know, other things. So ultimately, that can happen only when we are defining markup language and we are enforcing these rules. That consent assumption framework thing, you know, I will be covering in my design. So as I said in the morning, that NDSP talks about the opt-in model, which is the explicit model. Sorry, opt-out model. So, opt-in model. Data not exchanged by default until patient consents. So by default, nothing will be assumed. By default, it will not be assumed that patient has given the consent or not, but there are certain corner conditions which have been raised by different organizations. Like what will happen if patient is unconscious, is brought unconscious in emergency, his record need to be exchanged with other provider and he's not in a position to give his consent. So there are certain kind of relaxations to the law can be given, consent can be given, but that should record should be secured by other kind of security controls. And that is again for a limited time period, till the time patient is in a position to give his consent back. So those kind of, you know, privileges related things need to be defined in that consent. Now this is a data control, data transport thing, you know, we are talking about. So Dr. Pankaj has always been saying that, you know, we should have a level 3 security. I would say it should be level 3-4 kind of security. And we discussed about the 7 layers of the thing. In one of my HL7 related class, I covered these 7 layers. Starts from the physical layer, which is actually your Ethernet, modem, optical fiber, whatever. To next level is data link layer, which is your VLAN, WLAN, etc. Then network layer, you have IP4, IP6. And then on top of that, you have transport layer, which is TCP or UDP. And then on top of that, you have the application layer. So in my opinion, and what, you know, people generally say is we should have security at the application layer, transport layer, internet layer, minimum. So we have different models for this, and we have kind of TLS, transport level security, SSL. And on top of that, we have secure networks, using the virtual, you know, IP networking or MPLS, those kind of things. So we should ensure the data packets are secured. And then we should have the encryption, decryption of the data packets, digital signature. So all these techniques should be followed for securing the data. Now, this is the actual data exchange, and, you know, we have already covered it many times. So when you are kind of exchanging the data, it should be a common record format. So for the common record format, we need to publish all the standards. So we need to say, like, these are the code directories, these are the value sets, and these are the, because the code directory can be huge. So for example, like, we have more than 70,000 ICD-10 codes, but now COVID has come. So suddenly, different organizations, they are going to develop their own applications. We should be publishing all the COVID-related SNOMED CT terms, or, you know, whatever temporary ICD codes have been allocated to the COVID diagnosis conditions or lawing thing or whatever other thing. So this will be a subset of the complete vocabulary, which is covering COVID part. So we can say it's a COVID-related value set, because it's just a specific set of coding terms, or, you know, different codes which are pertaining to COVID. The same way for NHA, we can have some specific, you know, terms which have to be used by the NHA thing. MOHFW can also decide how many diseases they want to publish the value sets. Because all the 70,000 ICD code, I don't think anybody is using in the country. So those will be the value sets basically. And we should be publishing that in some sort of, you know, terminology server. So that will be used in the data exchange part. The other thing is the standard information metadata to be included in the data transmission. So Ved is already working on the Jadu software. So that will take care of all the data transformation at the API level. Then we will like to do some more research on that part, like the web ontology based mediation. So nowadays, you know, US and different countries, they are talking about the RDF framework and the web ontologies, triplet stores and the SPACURL APIs. So these are sort of different from the common traditional approach that we follow. So we will be doing some sort of research. I and Ved will do on that part. Then over and above of that, we need the SSD schemas, so that different data engines, when they are kind of populating the data in different repositories or different data stores, they can do some sort of you know, data mapping using those SSL-based, SSD-based transformations. So again, we are working, we are going to publish the MDDS elements based SSD schemas. So that everything will be used in the data exchange part. And so ultimate outcome of that work will come out as the data set, which will be our e-objects, code sets, which are all the code directories and the value sets we are publishing. The registries, we are already published the MVP elements of the registries, and now we have to publish the interaction APIs and the vocabularies, all the terminologies. So these all are relevant in the data exchange part. So basically, HIPAA conditions are quite elaborate. It talks about data de-identification and aggregation thing at the statistical level, safe harboring of data, limited data set, data aggregation thing. Our NDHP report, and I already covered in the morning, it particularly talks about anonymization, deduplication, encryption, decryption, de-identification. So we have to propose all these models. And this will be part of our HIE framework thing. So as I said in the morning, all the anonymization, deduplication should be handled as close to the point of source as possible. And this is the data warehousing part. So NDHP says each and every state will maintain the state level data warehouses. And over and above, NHA will have its own data insights project. So they will maintain their own data warehouses. Plus national level, we will have the data warehouse for all the indicators. So basically data warehousing is it's an act of putting data into some sort of database in a denormalized manner. So normal database is highly normalized. In the data warehouse model, we have the schemas. We have the star schema, snowflake schema. So we have a different way of designing the meta models of the data warehouse models, and it's primarily used for analysis purpose. So we have dimensions and we have facts. So this is a bit of different from the translational databases. So analytics is basically like a science of analyzing the data using different tools. And nowadays we have got very advanced tools also. So we have got, the traditional analysis approach is the OLAP approach, which is online analytical processing. So we have got all the data, we have loaded it in the data analytical models. So first of all, we collect all the data in the staging area. We do all the transformation part in that. Then we load the data into our analytical models, which are generally developed in star schema model and everything. And then on top of that, we build the metrics, indicators, dashboards, KPIs, and we get all these reports. This is a traditional OLAP model. Now the advanced models are, predictive model, neural network, fuzzy logic, decision trees, data mining, or genetic algorithms, business intelligence. So those kind of things are used in predictive modeling as well as the reason-based, AI-based approaches basically. So those are kind of detecting the patterns in the data. So if today certain thing, based on this pattern, what will happen, after a certain time, kind of making some inferences out of that. So this is a data lake architecture we are working in our HIEF report. So we have kind of identifying all the data sources, what are the different data sources from NHA standpoint, from the provider space standpoint, how the data onboarding will happen, how the data integration thing will be happening in there, and how will we discover and explore the data patterns out of that, what will be the strategy for visualization and analytics, and what will be the intelligence trends out. So these are the different techniques and technologies that will be used in this overall analytics thing. So Hadoop is for the big data thing, you all know. AWS is a cloud storage. So this is a data lake, federated data lake architecture that we kind of envisaging. So Vivek is working on that part. So on the left-hand side, you can see all the different data sources. So these data sources can be fiduciary repositories. This can be patient PHR repositories, or this can be directly some government sources or some other databases. So all the data will be kind of first extracted, loaded, and transformed into some systems, some staging areas. We call it ELT. So there is a fundamental difference between the two terms, ELT and ETL. So ELT is extract the data from the system, load, you mean load it in the staging area, and then transform, which is kind of transformation after loading. So pehle tum sara kachra le lo, ikhatta kar lo, aur fir usko theek karo. That model is called ELT. Aur dusra model jo hai wo ye hai ki extract, then transform, and then load. If you get the data, transform it before loading. So yani kachra pehle hi hat jana chahiye usko store karne se pehle. So primarily ETL is more expensive strategy than ELT. Because ETL में आपको रन टाइम में सारे ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन करने पड़ेंगे और तब जाके आप उसको स्टोर कर पाओगे, तो आपका जो रन टाइम कॉस्ट ऑफ प्रोसेसिंग होगा बहुत बढ़ जाएगा. तो जनरली वी आर कमिटिंग गवर्नमेंट स्टैंड पॉइंट से ELT विल बी अ राइट अप्रोच, बिकॉज यू आर गेटिंग द डाटा फ्रॉम ऑल द सोर्सेज, और उसमें और भी डाटा सोर्सेज आएंगे, लाइक यू हैव द IoT बेस्ड सेंसर्स, यू विल हैव पॉइंट ऑफ डिवाइसेज, and then tele radiology, telemedicine, the sensor based devices होंगे. So your basically data is the new oil. This is a term everyone is using. So generally, when you are getting such a larger magnitude of data, so ELT is the right approach to start with. And after you have loaded all the data in the staging area, obviously that data will be anonymized, reduplicated, and then on top of that, the quality controls will be processed. So the Q part is all the quality control related things. That will be the data cleansing part, data transformation part, feedback part. So those things, like for example, conversion into MDDS thing, or whatever other data standardization approaches need to be followed. And once the data has been kind of cleaned, that need to be loaded into the state level data lakes. So these will be the different analytical databases which will be maintained at the state level. So each state has to maintain minimum one data warehouse instance. It can have many also. And as I discussed, that MIT or NIC health clouds will be kind of hosting these data warehouses. So these state data lakes will be populated. And in the state data lake, we'll be defining the different data marts. So these will be the different analytical models that will be designed. How you want to see the data. For example, in NHA, we have kind of collected all the data from the claims. Now we want to see that certain different indicators or KPIs that we have designed for the NHA. So for that, we need to build the data marts. So that part will be in the lake. And you can see there will be different tools that will be required. At the bottom, I have mentioned all the tools here, like metadata, governance tools, data security privacy, data service bus. So data service bus is required for connecting all these pieces together, because from the state data lake, you need to push certain data to the central data lake. So you have another data lake, central data lake. But central data lake will be maintained at the center. So you have to only send certain minimum data from the state lake to there. Only data that is relevant for the indicators. You need not to send all the data there. So again, for the indicators, you will be creating all the schemas. So generally, we use a DHIS application for that, and it uses a technology called STMX. So STMX, like HL7 is one technique for exchanging the clinical data. STMX is a technique for exchanging the indicator-related aggregated data. So STMX we can use for exchanging all the data from state data lake to the central data lake. So we need a kind of service bus for that, which will be connecting all the different lakes together. And from the central data lake, then we can view all these different reports. And then you can see that in the discovery part, we have different tools and algorithms we will use. So there will be AI-based mechanisms. There will be traditional analytical tools for generating the dashboards, analytics, or kind of training data sets, basically, from where, or we call it models, AI models. Using that we can do the different data inferences. Okay, abhi diagnosis ye chal raha hai, temperature ye chal raha hai. Ye dawai di gayi thi, uske baad mein itne logo ko corona theek ho gaya, itne logo ko nahi hua. So based on that, we will start generating the patterns. So all these ML AI related patterns will come. So for that, we need the machine module. So this is a high level. And then on the last side is the visualization analytic part. That are the different apps that will be designed, or the web portal. HMIS portal, जो सारे NHRM जितने भी हैं, National Health Rural Mission, they all look at the indicator reports from the HMIS portal. So this is one application. Then different other applications can be designed for the surveillance, for example. We can develop the portals, or we can different other mobile applications, which will be accessed by the different user groups. So अभी इसपे काम चल रहा है. We will be elaborating more on this kind of architecture. So the health information exchange will be the underlying supporting platform which will support this overall data analytics layer. Usme jo ye data service bus hai, basically iske sath jo baki APIs hogi wo sab hamari health information exchange wali APIs connect ho jayenge. So that will be ensuring the flow of data from the EHR and PHR repository to the state data lakes, from state data lakes to the national data lakes. So that will make the complete health information platform for the country. Any questions here? Anyone in the analyst side, analyst team, want to ask any questions?
No, sir.
I know it's a little technical, but it's the thing you should all remember, because you know, we are in the direction of universal health coverage, and that cannot be achieved without a health information exchange.
Yes.
I think that's all for the day.
Thanks, Krishan.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I will share these slides. Maybe we can have more discussions on this thing. I know one sure. single session will not work, but yeah. it's like a giving a thought, food of thought kind of thing. So raising something in the mind, then you can elaborate more on that and discuss and brainstorm. Yeah.
I love this.
Is good.
I love the idea. It's a little technical.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir?
Yeah, Raghu.
So, like, we are providing with the technical architecture and design all the part, and but who will be
prepared?
Nahin, sir, technical on-field implementation.
We all will be doing that, and then we will identify more members from our SCA community who will be supporting us in that, and many more. So, तो हम क्या कर रहे हैं कि अभी एक kind of blueprint I will be putting on. So that will define कि क्या minimum open source components लेके हम एक pilot कर सकते हैं. And then we can identify the team. And... So basically, Raghav, one more thing is maybe in some of the session I will give you the basic definition things also. So जैसे इसमें some of the things are like. Okay, so I want to cover that part. You can still see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
One minute. Just give me a minute. So please let me know once you're able to see the screen. So some of the terminologies I have been using, so I want to kind of talk about those terminologies for understanding of analysting. Well, it's a little bit technical jargon. I will try to talk about. So one of the thing I'm talking about is the health information exchange. So Raghav and everyone, are you clear with health information exchange thing? What is that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
The other thing, you know, we are using the word EHR repository, PHR repository, and registry. You are somehow clear with these things? What is EHR repository? What is PHR repository? Or any doubt you have, please ask me.
Sir, I have a concern regarding the directories. What's the difference with that?
So I think one of the session I covered that part. Primarily in registry and directory, mein ek hi farak hota hai. Okay, registry mein you have to have a mandatory registration of the data. And directory can be any database. So basically, both are databases at the technical level, both are databases. But registry is kind of, there is a notification by the government that you have to register in that registry. So it can be, for example, आज के दिन में अगर हम बोलें कि सारी facilities हैं, hospitals हैं, they have to operate in the country and they have to mandatorily register in the facility registry. So this facility registry will be a database. Of all the facilities which are registered in the country and operating. जब हम डायरेक्टरी की बात करते हैं तो फॉर एग्जाम्पल हेल्थ वर्कर रजिस्ट्री है फॉर एग्जाम्पल तो now we are saying के जितने भी हेल्थ वर्कर्स हैं आशा रजिस्ट्री आशा ANM they have to register in the registry. But then we are talking about different applications जहां पर you know आशा and ANM are using. For example, the complete employment detail of the Asha ANM is managed by the employment related HR related applications. ठीक है? तो जैसे for example आशा ने कब join किया, उसका क्या life cycle है मतलब कि कब उसने job छोड़ दी, कब join की, कब retire हुई, उसको pay scale कितना है, बड़ा promotion कितना हुआ, ये सब normal databases हैं that need not be at the national level. So national level we have a NDT and there is an integration between the different applications with the this thing NDT thing. बट जो डिफरेंट स्टेट्स हैं, जो उसकी एम्प्लॉयमेंट मैनेजमेंट है, दे कैन डू विद द रिस्पेक्टिव एप्लीकेशंस. तो यदि हम कोई ऐसे डाटाबेस की बात कर रहे हैं विच इज काइंड ऑफ अ नॉर्मल डाटाबेस, अ नॉर्मल एप्लीकेशन डाटाबेस, वेयर अ स्पेसिफिक सेट ऑफ पीपल कैन जॉइन फॉर अ स्पेसिफिक पर्पस बट नॉट फ्रॉम ए ओवरऑल नेशनल पर्पस, तो हम उसको डायरेक्टरी वर्ड बोल सकते हैं. लेकिन जब हम नेशनल लेवल पे बोलते हैं कि नेशनल लेवल पे यू शुड हैव अ मैंडेटरी एंट्री इन दैट डाटाबेस, देन वी कॉल इट रजिस्ट्री. तो रजिस्ट्री पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से हमारे पास नेशनल लेवल पर पेशेंट रजिस्ट्री है, देन वी हैव फैसिलिटी रजिस्ट्री, डॉक्टर रजिस्ट्री, नर्सिस रजिस्ट्री, पैरामेडिकल्स की भी आएगी धीरे धीरे, देन हेल्थ वर्कर्स. सो ऑल दीज रजिस्ट्रीज दे हैव टू मैंडेटरी रजिस्ट्री. Raghav, I've tried to answer that in a very simple language. हालांकि technically तो बहुत कुछ इसमें बोल सकते हैं.
Yes, sir. Clear.
अच्छा, कुछ और terms हैं जो मैं आपको बताना चाहूँगा. जैसे last slide थी, I was talking about data model. So what is data model? Can anyone tell me? जैसे ये वाली application है, तो data model, जब भी आप database बनाते हैं हमेशा आपने देखा होगा, आप ये कोड डायरेक्टरीज पे भी काम कर रहे हो, तो यू हैव लॉट ऑफ टेबल्स यू आर क्रिएटिंग, राइट? सो व्हेनेवर यू आर काइंड ऑफ जनरेटिंग एंड डिजाइनिंग अ डेटाबेस, यू आर डिजाइनिंग अ सेट ऑफ टेबल्स, विद इन दैट यू नो यू आर डिजाइनिंग ऑल द कॉलम्स. हर एक कॉलम के लिए फिर आप उसकी लेंथ, टाइप, साइज वगैरह डिफाइन कर रहे हो. तो अल्टीमेटली यू आर डिफाइनिंग द डाटा मॉडल्स, यू आर मॉडलिंग द डाटा स्ट्रक्चर्स. सो basically MDDS is all about that. So MDDS, we are describing the data about data. तो एक तो होता है कि आपके पास डाटा एप्लीकेशन से क्या डाटा आएगा, जैसे आपने बोला कि डिस्चार्ज समरी में ये सारा डाटा आएगा. दूसरा है कि जो प्रियंका ने और आप सब ने ई डिस्चार्ज समरी को मॉडल किया, तो basically हम ये कह सकते हैं कि you have kind of designed the data model of the ई डिस्चार्ज समरी. You have defined कि ई डिस्चार्ज समरी में कितने सेगमेंट्स होंगे, कितने फील्ड्स होंगे, उनको फिर आपने MDDS के साथ लिंक किया है, then you have done a fire mapping of those elements, so you have sort of defined the data model for that. चल अगर ये शीट किसी को दे दें हम लोग और हम उसको बोले कि डिस्चार्ज समरी के लिए आप एक डाटाबेस जनरेट करो, तो he can create a database out of that sheet. So it's not necessary कि ये एक टेबल होगा, it will be a group of tables, it will be multiple tables, and these tables will be linked by primary key, foreign key. तो पूरा जो है डाटाबेस का मॉडल जनरेट कर सकते हैं वो using these key object structures. That is a data model. Raghav, any doubt in that?
नहीं सर, समझ गए.
अच्छा, दूसरा जो analytics के अंदर, तो primarily what is the difference between analytics platform and the data where this thing transitional database? तो जो भी application होती है, हर एक application के साथ एक database होता है. जैसे आप कोई भी HIS बना रहे हो, yes, clinical system है, सबके साथ एक अपना एक database होता है. तो जनरली वट एवर ट्रांजेक्शन आर डन इन दैट एप्लीकेशन, वो ट्रांजेक्शन का पूरा डाटा उस डाटाबेस में स्टोर होगा एज पर द डाटा मॉडल, जो डाटा मॉडल डिजाइन किया गया उसके लिए. तो लेकिन आप उस डाटा से जब आप मान लो कि एनालिसिस करना चाहते हो, नाउ यू वांट टू एनालाइज एक मान लो कि पैक्टो का या एक सृष्टि का कोई एक HIS सिस्टम है, उन्होंने किसी हॉस्पिटल में लगाया हुआ है. अब आप ये निकालना चाहते हो कि हाउ मेनी पेशेंट्स अंडर 25 ईयर्स have fallen sick with you know cold and cough. इस तरह की जो queries होती है ना, ये generally analysis queries होती है कि इस particular age group के कितने patients हैं जिनको ये condition हुआ है, ये treatment कितने का क्या effect उन पे हुआ है. तो generally these kind of analysis data query we can do. I mean in normal systems के अंदर भी हम करते हैं, लोग SQL programs लिख सकते हैं, we can generate all these reports. Generally ज्यादातर अच्छे ये system में reports होती हैं. As your data keep on growing, वो analysis को maintain करना, उनके लिए queries लिखना बड़ा cumbersome होता है. जो queries run करते हैं तो और भी cumbersome होता है. And one of the example was कि I had done one integration interface with the IFS, Scots के लिए किया था. तो IFS उनका पूरा financial data भी maintain करता था. और उसके लिए जब वो उनके जो profit loss statements generate करते थे at the year end, वो year end के आसपास का time था, तो Oracle का database था. शाम को लगाते थे वो query. अगले दिन शाम तक भी चली रही होती थी, उनकी क्वेरी नहीं कंप्लीट होती थी, बिकॉज सो मेनी जॉइंट्स आर देयर, देन यू नो एग्जीक्यूट उस सारे जॉइंट से डाटा लेना, क्वेरी का जनरेट करना, इट्स वेरी वेरी एक्सपेंसिव एंड टाइम टेकिंग. तो इसलिए there is always a requirement of a separate database which store the data in a different manner so that you can use the analysis out of that. So, tumhe analyze karna hai ki kitne sare patients hain jo pichle 6 mahine mein jinko ye vaccination diya gaya tha x vaccination day par unme y effect hua, unki health condition improve hui ya unko death ho gayi. That kind of data is a huge set of data. तो उसके लिए हमें जो क्या करना होता है कि नॉर्मल ट्रांजेक्शन डाटाबेस से हमें डाटा निकाल कर उसे लोड करना होता है डाटा वेयरहाउसिंग एप्लीकेशन के अंदर. तो जनरली लोड करने से पहले देयर आर सर्टेन स्टेजेस. पहला स्टेज होता है कि पहले हम सारा डाटा एज इट इज डाल नहीं देंगे, पहले हम एक सिमिलर डाटा बेस एक क्रिएट करते हैं जो हमारा एप्लीकेशन में होता है, उसको हम बोलते हैं स्टेजिंग डाटा बेस. एंड वी लोड द एक्सट्रैक्ट द डाटा फ्रॉम द एप्लीकेशन एंड लोड द डाटा. उसके बाद उसमें जो भी ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन करनी है, कोई क्लींजिंग करनी है, कुछ जो भी ऑपरेशन आपको करना है दैट विल बी, एंड देन वी विल डू द एक्चुअल क्रिएशन ऑफ द डाटा एनालिटिकल मॉडल्स. तो जो एनालिटिकल मॉडल्स होते हैं वो डिफरेंट, जो मैंने आपको बताया था कि स्टार स्कीमा होता है या स्नोफ्लेक स्कीमा होता है, उसमें हमको जो डिफरेंट जो आपके डैशबोर्ड्स आपको जनरेट करने हैं या इंडिकेटर जनरेट करनी है, उसके हिसाब से हम डाटा बनाते हैं. जैसे मान लीजिए कि आपने कहा कि पेशेंट परफेक्टेबल है, अब पेशेंट के आपके डायमेंशन क्या क्या होगी, डायग्नोसिस एक डायमेंशन हो गई और उसका मेडिकेशन एक अनदर डायमेंशन हो गया. तो ये सारे अपने फैक्टर डायमेंशन को क्रिएट कर दिया उसने, एंड देन यू हैव डिफरेंट वेज ऑफ क्रिएटिंग. आप स्टार स्कीमा बना सकते हो जिसमें आपकी एक फैक्टेबल होगी, मल्टीपल डायमेंशन होंगी, या स्नो फ्लैग बना सकते हो जिसमें आपके इसका कॉन्स्टिलेशन मल्टीपल फैक्ट्स होंगे, मल्टीपल डायमेंशन होंगे. तो ऐसा करके उसको आप डाटा क्यूब्स बना लेते हो, एंड देन ऑन टॉप ऑफ दैट यू कैन रन योर डैशबोर्ड्स, योर क्वेरीज, एंड यू क्रिएट अ विजुअलाइजेशन लेयर ऑन टॉप ऑफ दैट. विजुअलाइजेशन में आपको डैशबोर्ड बना दिया, डैशबोर्ड में आपने इंडिकेटर्स बना दिए. तो दिस प्राइमरली जनरेट योर एनालिटिकल डैशबोर्ड. जो हमारा नॉर्मल वे होता है उसको हम बोलते हैं ओलैप. तो वन टर्म इज ओएलटीपी व्हिच इज ऑनलाइन ट्रांजेक्शन प्रोसेसिंग सिस्टम, व्हिच इज योर नॉर्मल डेटाबेसेस और ट्रांजेक्शन मैनेजमेंट होती है, जैसे आपका एचआईएस हो गया, एलआईएस हो गया. और एक होता है ओलैप व्हिच इज योर ऑनलाइन एनालिटिकल प्रोसेसिंग, जो आपकी डाटा वेयरहाउसिंग एप्लीकेशन. तो आई वॉज टॉकिंग अबाउट द ओलैप एप्लीकेशन. और एक हम एक वर्ड यूज कर रहे हैं लेक. तो लेक का मतलब ये होता है कि you are getting the data from any source in whatever format and you are kind of storing. isme koi schema nahi hota, isme koi predefined schema hota, kyunki aapko nahi pata na ki aap 10 application se link kar rahe ho, 10 application ka kya kya database. to aapne common ye generally schema less architecture hota, schema aapka runtime pe generate hota and it can store all sort of data. ye pdf bhi store kar sakta hai, audio video files bhi store kar sakta hai, then your fire objects can also be stored, normal SQL database can also be stored, but ultimately it can store all sort of data and then it can use to populate the data warehouse. So any other term Raghav jo aapko lagta hai isme aur confusion hai to puchna.
Sir, sir,
bhai, data management tool hai basically. To as I was saying ki aapne sara data to load kar liya. अब डाटा लोड करने के बाद में आपको उसके अंदर उस फॉर एग्जांपल एमडीडीएस कन्वर्जन करना है. आपका डाटा जो है वो स्ट्रक्चर डाटा है, उसको आपको उसमें लेट अस से स्नोमैट में उसको ट्रांसफॉर्म करना है उसके टर्म्स को, या उसके जो डायग्नोसिस है उसको आईसीडी के साथ मैप करना है. तो यू नीड द टर्मोलॉजी सर्वर की जो एपीआईज है वो चाहिए. इसी तरीके से आपका जो ई ऑब्जेक्ट्स हैं, तो आपके पास फायर का ऑब्जेक्ट आ गया, वो पूरा रिसोर्स है, पूरा एक जेसॉन का डॉक्यूमेंट है. आपको पूरा डॉक्यूमेंट प्रोसेस करके उसके इंडिविजुअल वेरिएबल्स को बाहर निकालना है. अब उसके अंदर आपका बहुत सारा डाटा है. तो ये जो सारी जो स्ट्रक्चरिंग आपकी स्टोर डाटा की, आपका आपको डाटा ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन करना है. तो मान लो किसी डाटा के अंदर एक सिंपल एग्जांपल जो हम हमेशा देते हैं कि इसमें जेंडर कोड 10 आ रहा है, लेकिन आपको जो डाटा वेयर हाउस में डाटा भेजना है उसमें आपको एमडीडीएस के कोड फॉलो करना है. आपको बोलना है कि जेंडर में मेल होगा तो एम होगा और फीमेल होगा तो एफ होगा. अब जो भी डाटा अलग अलग फॉर्मेट में आ रहा है यू नीड टू ट्रांसफॉर्म इट टू अ स्टैंडर्ड मेटाडाटा, राइट. तो ये जो टूल आपको चाहिए, तो बेसिकली जो मेटाडाटा मैनेजमेंट टूल है, इट इज सॉर्ट ऑफ ऑल द ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन टूल्स, ऑल द मेटाडाटा मैनेजमेंट रिलेटेड यू नो डिफरेंट टेक्नोलॉजीज जो आपकी डाटा स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन में हेल्प करेगी. और इसमें एआई टूल भी हो सकते हैं, एमएल भी हो सकता है, टेक्स्ट एनालिटिक्स भी हो सकता है, नेचुरल लैंग्वेज प्रोसेसिंग भी हो सकती है. नेचुरल लैंग्वेज प्रोसेसिंग में ये होता है कि आपने जो क्लोजेस्ट मैचिंग टर्म्स होगी उनको भी वो मैप कर देगा अपने आप ऑटोमेटिकली. तो ये सारे जो टेक्निक्स हैं बेसिकली टू स्टैंडर्डाइज द डाटा इनटू ए स्टैंडर्ड फॉर्म, वो यूज होता है. गवर्नेंस टूल से मैं ये कहना चाह रहा हूँ कि सेम डाटा है लेकिन आप सेम डाटा हर किसी को तो नहीं दिखा सकते ना. अब एनएचए के अंदर सर्टेन फाइनेंशियल रिलेटेड डाटा ओनली इंदुभूषण एंड द टीम वांट टू सी. अब वो मनु एंड स्मॉलर जो नीचे टीम मेंबर्स हैं पीडब्ल्यूसी वाले तो नहीं देखेंगे ना उसको. सो काइंड ऑफ यू आर मैनेजिंग द डाटा गवर्नेंस के विच पोर्शन ऑफ द डाटा विल बी ओन्ड बाय विच एंटिटी. तो ये जो रोल एक्सेस होगा डाटा का बेस्ड ऑन द रोल एक्सेस जो आप उनको अलाउ करोगे रीड एक्सेस होगा राइट एक्सेस होगा कौन रीड कर सकता है कौन राइट कर सकता है डाटा को. सॉरी राइट तो कोई भी नहीं करेगा. कौन रीड कर सकता है कौन कितने इंडिकेटर्स देख सकता है कौन कितने डैशबोर्ड्स एक्सेस कर सकता है. तो ये सारा जो प्रिविलेज मैनेजमेंट होगा ये सारा गवर्नेंस टूल करेगा. एंड डाटा सिक्योरिटी एंड प्राइवेसी तो आपको पता ही है विच आई हैव सेड कि जो डाटा मैनेज आपने डाटा स्टोर किया है कलेक्ट किया डिफरेंट सोर्सेज से यू नीड टू एंश्योर कि डाटा प्रोटेक्टेड है एनक्रिप्टेड है एंड उसका कंसेंट वगैरह जो है वो अचीव हो चुका है. डाटा सर्विस बस जो है इट्स लाइक अ बस बेसिकली. तो बस का वाली बस नहीं है आपने सोच लो इट्स लाइक अ कनेक्टर. अब आप ऐसे मान के चलो कि देयर इज अ बिग पाइप. अब लेट अस से देयर आर थ्री और फोर सिस्टम्स व्हिच वांट टू कनेक्ट विद ईच अदर. एक तरीका तो ये है कि आप सबको एक दूसरे के साथ डायरेक्टली कनेक्ट कर दो. तो उसमें तो क्या होगा कि आपको हर सिस्टम को हर किसी सिस्टम के साथ कनेक्ट करना पड़ेगा. ईच सिस्टम विल कनेक्ट टू थ्री ऑफ द अदर सिस्टम्स. और दूसरा तरीका ये है कि यू हैव ए मिडलवेयर जहां पर आपने सारे सिस्टम्स को मिडलवेयर के साथ कनेक्ट कर दिया. तो विच ऑफ द अप्रोच इज बेटर. तो हब एंड स्पोक मॉडल हो गया ना कि आपने सबको डायरेक्टली एक दूसरे से पॉइंट टू पॉइंट इंटीग्रेट ना करके बीच में आपने गेटवे या सर्विस बस एक लेकर आए हैं. तो एवरीवन इज कनेक्टेड टू द सर्विस बस. अब उसमें से हो सकता है कि किसी को अचल सबन समझ में आता हो किसी को फायर समझ में आता हो किसी को एसक्यूएल समझ में आता हो. तो ये सब अडेप्टर्स होते हैं डिफरेंट अडेप्टर्स होते हैं. तो द डिफरेंट एप्लीकेशंस कैन कनेक्ट टू द सेम सर्विस बस इन डिफरेंट वेज. कोई एपीआई के थ्रू कनेक्ट करेगा कोई डाटाबेस कनेक्टर के थ्रू करेगा एसक्यूएल के थ्रू कोई फायर के थ्रू करेगा. बट अल्टीमेटली ऑल दीज आर कनेक्टेड टू द बस. बस के अंदर आपके पास ट्रांसफॉर्म करने का लॉजिक होगा जो आपका मेटा डाटा मैनेजमेंट टूल में बता रहा था. That will actually convert and transform the data into one standard format, and then it will load it to, you know, one common database. The common database aapka state level data lake architecture ho sakta hai ya national level data lake architecture. So these are the different tools which are used in the analytical layer. Dada, koi question isme?
Nahi sir, thank you.
Isko aur thoda padh lena, agar doubt hoga to aise lagega isko.
Haan ji, haan ji.
Or any other thing which I have missed out? You want to understand? Sounds good. Okay. Thank you so much. If you have any question, you can discuss again.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.